appropriate for any other time of the day or from wherever you're joining. Welcome to the masterclass organized as part of a project which examines the proposal of introduction of blockchain technology in Indian elections. This project is hosted by Karana, which is a collection of independent critiques of various aspects of digital India. My name is Shankarshan, and I'm a member of this collective. I'm also the curator and promoter of this project. The project is supported by hasgeek.com, which is a platform for collaborations across practices in technology, design, law, policy, systems, data, among others. Hasgeek.com and Hasgeek Media Division provide the underlying infrastructure, tools, and services to facilitate these collaborations. The reason we are conducting these masterclasses and webinars is to enable participants to acquire the foundational knowledge and perspectives required to evaluate the intended and unintended consequences of technology through diverse set of perspectives, which focus on identity, equity, privacy, security, rights, agency, and the socio-economic impact of such proposals. Additionally, I think one of the things that has become very clear to us as we have gone through a few masterclasses is that we need to find a way to understand the inherent issues in existing technology before we get fascinated by new technology. We tend to have some sort of a technology fetishism that allows us to jump from old to new without actually realizing what is the problem set that the new one is supposed to solve. What is the problem set that exists in the our existing set of technology choices that we have made? But more importantly, to be able to understand how deep the consequences of those problems are in not just our day-to-day life, but in the entire concept of democracy as we know it. So we have a fascinating talk lined up today. I say it is fascinating because it kind of mixes up two very interesting streams. One, what we call field notes from elections, how processes and steps are existing in current electoral processes. But more importantly, it also provides a perspective on cybersecurity. And I'm very stoked to have as our host and moderator, Shuman Kaur, who is a cybersecurity researcher and has been exploring various things around cybersecurity products and consulting. He runs Banbridge, a cybersecurity company based out of Kolkata. He believes in the right to privacy and has worked extensively on data breaches and responsible disclosures. One of his very important and significant contributions have been his analysis of the Bitcoin blockchain transactions provided one of the earliest estimates of financial losses due to extortions over email. With that, before I hand over to Shuman to continue with this session, a few housekeeping notes. This session is on Zoom as well as being streamed on YouTube. You can interject at any point during the conversation by using the raise hand process in Zoom. It should ideally be under the reactions options in Zoom, but if it's not, you probably have to find out exactly what it is in the Zoom build you are using. If you are on YouTube, then you can post your questions there and we'll relay them back to our Zoom channel, to our speaker and our moderator. On Zoom, if for some reason you prefer not to speak out your questions, it could be in a noisy environment or just not prefer speaking them out, it's absolutely fine. Please paste them in the Zoom chat and we would be able to relay it and read it out for you. With that, I'm going to hand it over to Shuma and take it away from here, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Shankarshan. I'm really, really excited. Actually, I've had a brief chat with Kannan and, you know, I have ever since been just thinking about questions. So, but before that, I wanted to spend 5 minutes, probably a little less, just introducing Kannan and his work, most importantly. Kannan Gopinathan is a former Indian administrative officer and an activist. He resigned in protest from the service due to the abrogation of Article 370, if I understand correctly. And he has since been a hugely impactful activist among everyone who's promoting public causes. In 2017, the Northeast Today named him as one of the five bureaucrats who've had who've made a huge difference in the Northeast. And part of that probably comes from his work in Mizoram, where he started curated Project HIMA, an early intervention and awareness program against drug usage among upper primary and high school students. And this was later scaled up across Mizoram. And then as district magistrate of Aizawl, he oversaw the disaster management framework and developed, and he won a citation as well for his work from the government of India. Then in 2018, he worked extensively to mitigate the damage from Kerala floods. And he was probably working at the, he was at the relief camps and working in on, from the front lines in flood hit Kerala. And then he was secretary of multiple departments in Dadra and Nagar Haveli, as well as Daman and Diu. And he was instrumental in transforming a loss-making government electricity distribution firm into a profit-making one. And he completed a two-decade delayed ring road project in Silvassa as well. Wow, amazing. So, and he has been one of the key voices raising concerns about current electoral technology, and we're going to hear more about that right now. So with that, Kannan, please.
Yeah, thank you, Suman, and thank you, Shankarshan and Zainab, for this opportunity to have a discussion here. In fact, I had attended the session the last week on the history of Indian elections. It was a very fascinating lecture. The last lecture was, I think, probably by Professor Subhashish Banerjee on the electronic voting principles and techniques, and a theoretical framework on that. And I have also been quite influenced by Professor Subhashish Banerjee's lectures and his own ideas and theories about electronic voting. And so I have met him. I have had long discussions with him quite a few times. So I could not attend the previous one because I was traveling. Today, I'm kind of mixing what actually happens in the field and also what the commission claims to be happening, should be happening with respect to the EVM and the VVPAT. And why and where did I find certain dissonance in the theories put forward, in the claims put forward, and the practices that are done in the field? And since I have been part of the system, I would like to make a few disclaimers up front. Questioning the veracity or the questioning the sanctity of the current system, the sanctity in the sense of the processes, or even saying that there are certain vulnerabilities that should be addressed, is not to say that elections have been hacked or the previous elections were all should be declared invalid. No, that is never the case. It is to raise certain concerns with respect to the current process, in the hope that we might be able to address them and get on to a better system, a better system which is transparent, accountable, and which is more importantly simple enough so that everybody can understand as to what is happening, because elections are as much a sovereign exercise as it is a democratic exercise. It is both. And this is election is through which we transfer power as citizens. We transfer our power as individual sovereigns to some elected people, saying that okay, now you be govern on our behalf, and that is one of the key aspects of electoral democracy. That is not democracy per se, but that is one of the key processes in a democracy, which defines at least that electoral democracy part. So elections that way are a key exercise. Now, elections, and I would like to correct a bit of an introduction that was done. I did not resign with respect to the abrogation of 370 per se, but what happened after 370, and that had to do with the fundamental rights, that had to do with the individual rights of the citizens. And I can't agree when a government is going beyond constitution and trying to get into, use executive powers to bypass constitution. And that is what I observed there. The fundamental rights to access, communication, transport, movement, all of it was curtailed. People were arrested, and that was one of the reason I felt it was not just the government. I felt the institution, the civil society, the media, all of us collectively failed to stand up and resist and say that is not done, at least not in the 21st century democratic India, that is not done. I felt that it is not in my interest to continue as if nothing has happened. So that is why I resigned. It is not exactly a policy decision with respect to 370 or not. So coming to elections, I'm sure many of you might have voted. So I can ask certain questions, right? Either to Suman or Shankarshan, or is it okay?
You can ask questions to everyone.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, so how many of you have voted in the recent elections? Anything 2019 or 20, yeah. 21? You have voted?
Yes. Yeah, voted.
Voted. Okay. Now, did you, you must have seen the VVPAT slip that is coming out. So you must have seen the name and the symbol on that VVPAT slip, right?
Yes.
Yes.
So all of you observed the name and the symbol. You must have also heard the claim from the Election Commission that EVMs are a standalone device. It is not connected to any external device, right?
Right.
Then have you ever thought how did the name of the candidates and the symbols got into the machine so that it can print it? No.
You have to program it.
No, yeah.
So,
but if you have to program it, you have to connect it, right? Means you can't program it from air. You have to connect it somehow through something.
Yes, and I think we use the same set of EVM machines across different states, right?
Yeah. And
so, yes, it has to be.
Yeah, candidates are known only 15 to 20 days before the elections are announced. Elections are, you know, poll date. So, elections are announced 45, 60 days before the election poll date, but candidate is only known after the nomination, withdrawal and the scrutiny stage, which is hardly 15 to 20 days before the poll date. So so that means a certain information that was only available 15 days prior to the poll date is printed by the EVM on the poll day. How is that possible if the EVMs are a standalone, unconnected device? Yeah, so that is the question that is a question that worried me also. So I will be trying to address that question. I wanted to raise this upfront because this particular thing has been what has led me to be, you know, as you said, an active campaigner on EVM, VVPAT based election process reforms and stuff. That is because of this particular question and the claim that the commission has been continuously doing that it is a standalone unconnected device. And I think I'll be covering a bit of it today. So before I go there, till 2017 or so, I was also a part of the EVMs are tamper proof, you know, you can't do anything with it kind of a brigade. And I have openly defended it. I have countered people on Twitter. Till even 2017, you will find one of my Twitter thread was later taken on and made it into an article by Oak India in 2017 or 18. And so I have been on the mostly on the defending EVM side. But when it came to 2019 elections and I was a returning officer, 2013 and 14, I was also part of elections, but then VVPAT was not being used. 2019 was the first Lok Sabha elections when, you know, across the country, VVPAT was being used. And that, so when we went to the training at IIIDEM, India International Institute for Democracy and Election Management. So there was a training for all the returning officers there. When I went there and it was casually told to us that VVPAT will print the name and symbol of the candidates and the voter would be able to verify. And that is where I asked this question, if it is standalone, then how does it know the name and the symbol of the candidates? So then they said the Bell and the ECL might be able to, you know, they enter it, they enter the data into it. You don't need to worry. But
I'm going to interrupt you 1 second here. I think we should just take a moment to explain what BHEL, you meant BHEL, right?
No, BEL, Bharat Electronics.
BEL, right. BEL. So they are the only ones for manufacturing the device.
No, Bell and DCIL both. So there are two.
DCIL both.
Yeah. So okay. Bell and DCIL are two PSUs which are manufacturing the EVMs and the VVPAT and all the manufacturing. Doesn't mean they make the ICs also. So that is another controversy which is.
That is a very, very, very interesting thing that you've just raised.
Yeah, so this is mostly that. Yeah, in fact, we will come there also a little bit further. So,
okay.
Why I used to defend 2017 till 2017 was that commission had drilled in a particular routine to all of us, or to the public also, and to the bureaucracy also. That is that EVMs, we are claiming it to be tamper proof. It is, cannot be hacked, not because it is technically not, we are not claiming that machines cannot be, no machine can be hacked or no, that is not what is being claimed. We are claiming that under these circumstances, under the physical process, administrative safeguards and the security arrangements that are there surrounding the EVM VVPAT that we have, it is not possible for it to hack without getting caught. So that was the paradigm of security that was put forward. It was more or less a custody chain argument and a trust-based argument of conducting elections. Custody chain means it is always with us, so don't worry. And trust-based means we are saying it, and since you trust us, you trust what I am saying also. So kind of these two arguments were what were put forward. I'll explain it as to what are the key components of that. One was the technical simplicity of the EVM. So commission always said that EVMs are a rudimentary device, very rudimentary, one-time programmable device, unconnected standalone device. And more often than not, it was said it is like a calculator, right? It is like a standalone calculator. And the question used to be, can you hack a calculator? If you can't hack a calculator, it is like a calculator. It is not connecting to the internet. It is not, you can't access the memory of it. So the question doesn't arise. So even though technically, if you go purely into that thing, you can hack a calculator also. But it convinced a lot of population as to, yes, it is a very rudimentary device, one-time programmable device, claiming to be JTAG had been fused and stuff. It is a standalone device, it's a calculator. Second part of that argument was physical security argument, which the commission said that, if you have a calculator, if the calculator is with me for a day, or I have physical access to that calculator, I might be able to hack it. Hacking need not be just connecting and, I can do n number of things, change the chip itself, change the more PCB itself and hack it. So once you get physical access, then you can do whatever you want. Like, so the commission said there is a physical security also. The physical security argument was that the machines, the moment it comes to the district, or it will be always transported with the police and magistrate arrangements. The moment it comes to the district, in the presence of political party representatives only, it will be kept in a strong room, and there will be a CCTV 24/7 paramilitary forces or the armed police forces which will be guarding it. And whenever the strong room is opened, it will be sealed. Whenever the strong room is opened, it will again be done in the presence of multiple political party representatives. So nobody has an access, a physical access to the EVM. So forget about all that, what you can do if you get a machine in your hand. That is not going to happen. The physical security argument was that. But more importantly, there are three more arguments that are put. That is called the administrative safeguards or a process safeguards that we have had. The process safeguards included the first one being candidate agnostic nature of the EVM. Candidate agnostic nature of the EVM meant that EVMs do not know electronically, as an electronic machine, EVMs don't know candidate one is who or which party, or candidate two belongs to which party and who is the candidate. It's not, it is not known to the EVM as an electronic device. If I have to just share share a bit. So if you see here, so is this visible? The ballot unit that is there?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so if you see like this, this is what is called as, pasting the ballot paper, the pasting the ballot paper onto the ballot unit. So the ballot unit has so many 16 buttons, blue buttons that you can see. And for, so it is like button one, button two, button three, button four, button six. Now, to enable the voter to know that button one is corresponding to X voter or Y voter or Z voter, what we do is we don't electronically feed anything to the BU. I'm talking about pre-VVPAT machine, okay, right now. So we just paste the candidate sequence, but this is known as Form 7A, the candidate sequence onto the ballot unit. So we just paste it on top of it. That's all. There is nothing electronically uploaded onto the ballot unit. Similarly, at the time of counting also, the control unit, if you see, if you press the result, it will just say candidate one, so many votes, candidate two, so many votes, candidate three, so many votes. It will never say candidate one is so and so, and let's say BJP or Congress or whatever, and these many votes. No, machines were candidate agnostic. It had no idea. It was button one, candidate one, button two, candidate two. It was only that. Only at the interface wherein the voter had to vote this paper, through this paper which is pasted onto the ballot unit, the voter is facilitated, okay, button one corresponds to voter one, candidate one. Similarly, what we have is a Form 7A. At the time of counting, again, we have this, and we know that candidate one means whoever is on the first, in the Form 7A, that sheet. So machines as such were, what do you call, candidate agnostic electronically. Second thing was that people...
Kannan, just a second. Yeah, sorry. So there are a couple of questions. Yes. So do you want to take them now?
Let me just complete this part of TV, cool. EVM, and I think probably sure. That would be the...
cool. Okay.
So now candidate agnostic also meant people could ask this question that, so what? We can do it before the machines had arrived in your strong room, right? It came, you start all these political parties, CCTV, all those military, etc., these armed forces, etc., armed police force, etc. At the time, it reaches your district. But it is manufactured elsewhere. The chip is coming from elsewhere. It is coming, all this, all these things are happening elsewhere. Then why can't it be done that it can be done at that time? One of the defense towards that was, since we don't know who is candidate one, who is candidate two, who is candidate three, and intelligent pre-programming was a little difficult unless there is an intervention after the candidates have been finalized, right? So the EVMs are coming to the district around 2 months before the poll date. Many a times we reuse the EVMs which are there. Many a times we need additional EVMs or an entirely new EVMs come from other districts or from the manufacturers, and it is then kept. But it comes around 2 months before the elections. And at that point of time, when it comes, you don't know who are the candidates. And so it is very difficult. And also an intelligent way to do it would have been to know if, I can electronically know, okay, I check some pattern or something and find out that, okay, one is X and this party, two is this, then I may be able to do an intelligent manipulation. But that is also not possible because we are not electronically feeding anything to the ballot unit and the control unit. This was the first process safeguard as, and candidates are known when? Candidates are known once the election is announced, which is around 45 to 50 days or 60 days even. That is when the model code of conduct kicks in, the election commission has that press conference saying that election date is on. So from that day onwards, model code of conduct kicks in. But candidates are not known then. Around then they fix at the time of the press conference itself, they will issue a schedule of elections. And in the schedule of elections, one of the key part would be the nomination day, nomination period. There will be a certain days during which candidates can come and nominate themselves as the candidate from a party or individual or registered party, whichever, independent. And after that, there is a day set for scrutiny. Scrutiny is where the returning officer would say, and okay, this candidate has to be disqualified. Like we had cases wherein, like in Banaras, there are candidates disqualified. In other places, there are candidates disqualified. So this disqualification happens during the scrutiny. And after that, there is a day that is given for withdrawal. Like if you doesn't want, or many a times what happens, parties also field one or two candidates, in case one of the candidate there this gets rejected during scrutiny, they will automatically have a substitute candidate to fight for. Otherwise, what will happen? The party will not have any candidate to fight for. So the one-day withdrawal is usually for the people who don't want to. They're otherwise eligible now, scrutiny is done. They can also withdraw and their nomination. After the withdrawal comes a particular step called as symbol allotment. Symbol allotment for the national parties, the state recognized parties, and many of the registered parties, the symbols are already allotted by the election commission itself. But there are many other parties and which do not have symbols there, and also independents who do not have symbols there. They give symbols as a preference. And there are some 1,500 symbols which are there. And from that, free symbols. And from there, they choose one, two, three in their three orders, and then they give. And there is a process by which we decide as to who should be getting the preference if there is a conflict between two people on a symbol. The national parties, state recognized parties, and all are fixed within the state. But for the other, there is a symbol allotment process that is done. And the symbol allotment process is completed, and you have what you call as a Form 7A or a candidate list form, which is published. Candidate list again has first category is national parties, state recognized parties, then, you know, other registered parties, then independents, etc. And within that, you will have your alphabetically ordered, right? If there are Congress, BJP, NCP, etc., etc., the national parties, let's assume, then within them, we will see who is coming alphabetically first. Let's say it's an English speaking state. So you will find whether somebody is Abhilash or somebody is Suman. So Abhilash would come first and Suman would come next. So the candidate sequence is also finalized at that point of time after the withdrawal. Now, this is the time symbol allotment, candidate sequence finalization. And this is usually done 15, 20 days before the poll date is done as per the schedule of the elections. And this Form 7A is published. It's published in the Gazette. That these are your candidates to the constituents, saying that these are the candidates who are standing for elections, and these are their symbols, and this is their sequence. Now it is up to you to vote for whoever you want. Now this is done only that time. So this becomes a, there is an uncertainty involved and, as to who can come at what number in a candidate. And hence it also became as a check towards any pre-programmed manipulation. That was one of the check that was said. Second part of it was during this process of safeguards. Initially, I said the technical one, rudimentary, blah, blah, blah. Physical one, all the CCTV, armed police force, etc. Then the third one, process safeguards. The first one was candidate agnostic nature. Second one is what we call as randomization. We have two-stage randomization. One, when the election, the machines have come to the strong room in the districts, you do what you call, after some time, you do what you call a first level check, wherein you check all these machines. And after a certain time, you also do a randomization, first randomization. So each district might have multiple assembly constituencies. Some might have 12. I had in Aizawl 14. So there are in Dadra Nagar Haveli, there were no assembly constituencies because there were no legislature. So it can vary. Now, what you do there is you randomly assign a set of ballot unit serial numbers and a set of control unit serial numbers. So EVM has two components before the VVPAT, ballot unit and control unit. A set of ballot unit serial numbers and a set of control unit serial numbers independently to a particular constituency. And so we don't know which constituency it was going. It is now randomized. The second level of randomization happens immediately after what is this Form 7A. The 7A is completed. That is what is known as this candidate symbol allotment, etc. is done. And then you do a randomization wherein you decide which EVM is going to which booth. So, you know, there might be 200, 300 booths in a particular constituency. We do earlier randomization fixed in across to the constituencies. The second randomization now decides as to which ones will go to the which booth. Now, this is also the time the BU and the CU comes together. One serial number of a BU, one serial number of a CU will come together and become what you call as an EVM together. And then it gets assigned to a particular booth, whichever polling station it is. So two stages of randomization. This also acted as a check because unless you know which constituency the EVM is going, unless you know which booth the EVM is going, a targeted manipulation becomes difficult in a way, because unless you have again access after the election. So this targeted in the sense you don't want manipulation in all the booths. You want manipulations in a certain booths where there is a kind of a variance that you expect, and you don't want that to happen. So that was there. Then what is called as a three-level mock polls are there, which is again part of this process safeguard. And this is the most convincing steps of all for the political parties involved. The first one is done before the announcement of elections itself during the time of first level check, FLC. Now, FLC is a stage when all these political party representatives are called. At that point, candidates are not there. The recognized political parties are called, and in their presence, in their representatives' presence, the staff from Bell or ECIL, they would come and they would start checking whether these functionings are properly or not. And then they would go ahead and also do a mock poll of 1,200 votes, randomly, but on dummy candidates. We'll assume alpha, beta, gamma or something. And then we do 1,200 votes on 1% of the machines, another 800 votes, if I'm not wrong, on 2% of the machines, and 500 votes on another 2% of the machines. So total 5% of machines are taken, and 1,200, 800, 500 kind of a distribution is done there. This is not a sampling. This is a search, okay? Because if we find, let's say there are 100 EVMs and we take 5%, that is 5, and let's assume that one has malfunctioned, then we don't assume that 1 out of 5 means 20 out of 100. We don't assume that. If it is a sampling, then that is how you will do. But this is not a sampling. This is a search. That means if one is wrong, we will just keep it aside and we'll take another one, and then we'll fill that 5% requirement. Okay. So the 5% has to be checked. That's all. It is not saying that you have to take, if there is any error in that 5%, then you have to check, the checking percentage should accordingly increase statistically. That doesn't happen. We just search that 5% only. And that 5% is done. And that is the first mock poll wherein the political party representatives come and check during the. Now, the second mock poll happens is, as I said, after the symbol allotment, the second randomization, Form 7A, et cetera, is published, that 15, 20 days before the poll date, what we call as a process called as commissioning. Now, you said BU and CU has come together, and now we have the list of the candidates also. Now, what we do right now, what is showing in this presentation, this is a process of commissioning of the EVMs, wherein that he is pasting that ballot paper. This is a Form 7, a sample of a ballot paper, which is pasted on the ballot unit. This is also tied to the, connected with that cable to the CU, and, seen whether it is working fine or not. At this stage, again, once it is connected, and now it is assigned to each booth. Now, after that is done, around 5% is again taken, and 1,000 votes are cast again. 1,000 votes are cast in presence of now candidates' representatives, because now candidates are not, their representatives are coming. And in their presence, it is done. And this goes on. It is a search. It is not a sampling. Search, if there is something wrong, it is kept aside and send it to Bell and ECL for repair. Otherwise, we find 5%. Then the third mock poll that is done is on the day of poll. All the other two mock polls were actually now 5%, 5%. On the day of poll, we do 100%. All the booth is supposed to be. The machines reach there a day or before the poll is to be done. On the day of poll, early morning, 7 o'clock, 6 o'clock, depending upon the start of the election, in the presence of polling agents. Polling agents are the candidates' agents who are assigned to the booths. Many of them come, many of them don't come, but at least major political parties try to keep their polling agents reach on time to the booths. And in their presence, some 50 votes are cast, not 1,000 or 1,200 or anything. Some 50 votes are cast, and in all the booths, and in their presence, and then after the 50 votes are cast, the result is checked, and they have to verify whether the count has come correctly or not, and they will give a mock poll certificate, and it is reset, and the actual election starts. So this was the security or whatever the argument from the election commission, or the claims that why these are a very, very strong you know, it is tamper proof or it cannot be hacked. And even if it is hacked, it can be detected. One of the key concerns on the security front is if there is an undetected change in the software, it should not lead to an undetectable change in the outcome. You know, there has to be steps through which you are able to identify the changes in the outcome. So here through mock polls, et cetera, you're trying to find out whether something has gone wrong and whether it is now trying to do something else. We'll come to certain aspects of it, but this was the reason. This was drilled in, not in just in public, but it's also drilled into all the bureaucrats. So any of you trying to have a conversation with any of the bureaucrats, especially the ones who have not worked on VVPAT and at least not be very fresh with the debates around the VVPAT, they would all give you these arguments. It is not about electronic voting machine and it's what is going on inside. It is, we know that if there is anything wrong, we know we'll be able to catch it. And that confidence comes from these checks that are there. You know, this environment in which the EVMs are to function, and that we are so confident of. I think at this stage, I'm supposed to come to why I changed my views. But I think this is a stage I can take some questions. And if I'm going very slow or I'm taking a lot of time, please tell me, Suman or Shankarshan, please.
Shankarshan, you want to comment on the speed? I think it's fantastic.
Let's continue. Let's just look at a few questions that have come in. And I think Anand had the first set of queries. Anand, I'm reading them out on your behalf, if that's okay. I think this was related to how the list of candidates there in the EVM, and he wanted to know that how is that programmed into the EVM?
Yes. Correct. Now that is actually done through with the BU and the CU only. So here, if you in this picture, I think it's very interesting that you asked this question. It is masked. I think it will be on the right of everybody. The rightmost ballot unit, if you see on the picture. There are only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There are only 9 which are there, you know, right? And the rest of the buttons, the blue buttons, which are supposed to be, they're masked. And that is done by opening it up and physically closing those masks, nothing electronically done there. And then the BU and the CU are connected, and then you do what you call as a candidate set. And candidate set is done by pressing the last button on the ballot unit, whichever is the last that is to be done. And through that, the number of candidates is set, not by connecting any other device, any external device. It is only connecting these two only, with these two machines only. We are saying that the unwanted buttons are masked physically, and the last button is used to convey to the CU that this is the number of candidates or the last candidate that is there. Now this can, if there are more than 16 or 48, et cetera, then a large number of such ballot units would come. I think here they are using 3 or I don't know if it's the same or not. Anyway, this is just a sample picture. So I hope that I have answered. So can I go ahead with the VVPAT concern now?
So hang on. So a couple more questions actually. Vijay Vithal Jahagirdar from, and he's watching it on YouTube. He asked that he voted in assembly and after that could not get his name on voters list after relocating. So do you want to shed some light on how voters list is constructed?
Okay. That is an entirely different topic actually. Can I take that? I'll definitely will take the question, but maybe after I complete, because this flow on the EVM VVPAT after I complete, if that is okay?
Yeah, I think that's fine. I think there is another interesting question. So EVM programming seems to have stoked up quite a bit of questions. So Samir has questions. Who programs the EVMs? Who does firmware upgrades? To whom does it go for maintenance? Which company? And it just goes on from there. I think it's let's kind of address this for a moment before switching to other things.
Yeah. So that is as much a mystery to us also as because what we do is we send it to Bell or ECL. If it is a Bell EC EVM, we send it to the concerned manufacturer. That is Bell. If it is ECL, then we send it to the ECIL. So there are two kind of machines. And is there any firmware upgrade? If there is, you know, there are. What is one thing is clear made to the district is that no repair should happen on the field. So in the field means once the machine is there with us in the districts, there cannot be no on the field repair. If at all anything has to be done, it has to be sent back to the Bell. Now, Bell, ECIL, whether they send it to some other agencies or whether they do it in-house, what the commission claims is that they have a three-tier security secured area in, within the Bell and ECIL thing, dedicated for the EVMs itself. But then I found out that 2018, Bell had actually issued a public tender for PCBs of symbol loading units and VVPATs, etc. So if they are getting the PCBs manufactured through a tender, open tender, then yeah. So these questions, please don't expect exact answer from me. These are the questions that I am also asking the commission. But in limited understanding, it goes back to the Bell, ECIL, whichever is the manufacturer.
And Yogesh Kirikumar had a question. Is the order of candidates fixed across all polling booths in the same constituency?
Yes.
I guess so, right.
So once in the constituency, as I said, as Form 7A is done, once it's done, so that Form 7A, or as what you see in this sheet, it's like this sheet only, exactly like the sheet with this ballot sheet that you've seen here. It is a sequence of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 with the names in English and whichever are the official languages. Later, they added the photographs and also the symbols. So all these would be there in the ballot paper or Form 7A. Your ballot paper comes essentially from Form 7A, and that will be a single one for a constituency. So candidate sequence will remain exactly the same for every single booth within a constituency.
Right, so that also answers Yogesh's next question, where he asks that are the names alphabetized and then randomized? I don't think they're randomized at all.
No, they are not randomized. They are alphabetized. Okay. In fact, they are just ordered in the and it is a very tricky affair because it has to be done in the language of the state, right? In the so it cannot be, if it is in Bengal, so it has to be first written in the official name in Bangla, and then you have to find out what is the correct sequence. And so that is like a little bit of a nightmare for a lot of because any mistake there becomes a reason for later the election to be countermanded and invalidated. Any mistake forming in Form 7A becomes a very serious issue later. So yeah, it is the same sequence. There is no randomization involved. It is just there are three categories mentioned: national, state, registered, and independent. A national, state, recognized together, registered, and then independent. And then within that, each of that, you will find, I could have probably shown a Form 7A, but you can find it. You just search Form 7A for any constituency, you'll just find it, the exact three categories and their sequences mentioned.
All right, so we'll take one question more and then we'll move on to the VVPAT. Era, okay? And that last question would be, so does the BLO, I believe this is the booth level officer. Does the booth level officer have to enable voting before each individual presses a button? This is a question from Yogesh again.
Okay, that is not BLO. BLO is a completely different guy. So BLO is involved in what you call as the electoral role and voter list management. Okay. What you are mentioning here is a presiding officer. In every booth, there are three or four people who man the election. There is a presiding officer, there is a PO1, PO2, PO3, polling officer 1, polling officer 2, polling like that. And presiding officer, there is an exact list of, there will be what will the presiding officer do, what will the PO1 do. Somebody would be verifying your name in the sheet. Another person would be marking the ink on your finger. Another person would be sitting there with the control unit, whereas the ballot unit will be there in that compartment. And every time, person would say, after the vote has been registered, the control unit is pressed to say that, okay, now it is again open for voting, so that the voter who goes there can do it. Yes. So yes, presiding officer has to enable the ballot unit for a vote through by enabling the control unit after every vote. Is that clear?
Let's I think that's good. Let's move to the VVPAT section and we'll see if there are more questions later. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So this is very interesting actually. Yeah. So what happens after after the VVPATs were introduced is that, so our entire argument, we never mentioned in this argument whether what is there inside the VVPAT, what are the chips, what kind of microcontroller is used, or is there any kind of a connectivity issue, none of it. We base these arguments around the concept, you know, which is not exactly inside of the EVM, but what is outside of the EVM. And that is how commission has convinced and convinced bureaucrats, convinced officials, political parties, everybody to trust this, that this is something that you all can verify. You don't have to just rely on some technocrat to say that this is done. So now there comes the VVPAT, and I'm sure this is visible. You see a VVPAT slip here. Can you see a VVPAT slip?
Yes.
This is like a VVPAT slip, right? So can you tell what are the things that you see in this?
There's a session information.
Yes, there's a session information.
There okay, is, I'm worried. There's a serial number.
There is a serial number.
And then, this is the candidate name in the language of the state, right?
Yes, there is a candidate name. There is sequence of the candidate, serial number of the candidate, and there is a symbol of the candidate. So this, and there is more information. I can actually show this. Is this visible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So now this is actually that is an actual VVPAT slip. This is from Bell's PDF document, publicly available. I have also tweeted about the link and everything on Twitter. It's not publicly available in the sense Bell has not published it. Some election commission officer had somewhere uploaded this inadvertently. And so I have archived it and then put it here. So this is from the official documents only. So there is a serial number of VVPAT. There is a poll session number. There is a candidate name. So here ideally the two languages should come. Then there is a candidate symbol. There is a candidate serial number. So these are the information that is available in the VVPAT. Now this is where the question should come as to how does the VVPAT know all this? This was exactly my question also, that how did the VVPAT know all this information? So what happened was that we had this concern as to where is the what happened to the vote when the vote is going from a ballot unit to the control unit. Ballot unit to the control unit. I am pressing button one. I know also some light is showing, but I don't know what is getting registered or recorded or stored inside the control unit. And this was one of the key concerns, like cast as intended, recorded as cast, and counted as recorded. So in that principle, there is something amiss, because I don't know whether it has got, I'm showing it is cast as intended, but I don't know whether it is recorded as cast. And I also don't know whether it is counted as recorded. So this essential principle of a fair voting process is somewhere, our pre-VVPAT EVM machine was found to be inadequate. And there are a lot of concerns, a lot of questions being raised, books being written, petitions being filed in the court for improvement in the process. And that has always been the case. We started our election process with in 1951 or something like that, with every candidate having their own ballot box. See, if there are 16 candidates, there used to be 16 ballot boxes. And you put a paper in any one of that. And from there, we changed to one ballot box and ballot paper was for the candidate, multiple candidates. Then we introduced the EVM. Then from EVM questions were raised. And then we came to EVM plus VVPAT in around 2013-14 period. So this concern, how do I know as a voter, what I pressed is what is stored in the control unit? How do I know this? And this is where the answer as a VVPAT or a water verifiable paper audit trail came in. And this has been under discussions in many of the computer science papers and electronic voting machines in 90s, if I'm not wrong, in the 90s and early 2000s also, that VVPAT is the way forward because you need an independent verifiable mechanism to ensure that the electronic voting is correct, it's correct, accurate. So for that, you need an independent verifiable mechanism. And one way to do it, probably the only way to do it, is to go for a paper trail, which can accompany it. And that is how VVPAT had come in. Now, when we introduced VVPAT, we did some very interesting jugaad. Because as you know, we had these, ballot unit and control unit already with us. And this would only connect, there is only one cable. If you look at this ballot unit, you will see there is only one cable coming out from here. And that cable it's a 9-pin serial connector. It will go to the control unit. It's supposed to go to the control unit. Now, we have a concern as to we have to introduce a new device into this. That is a VVPAT. Now, where do we keep? And we can't make new CUs and BUs. We can't make new BUs and CUs. And if we have to add another device, we need to add another port, right? If control unit is to connect to ballot unit and to the VVPAT, our control units needs to be now redesigned so that it is able to communicate with VVPAT also and also to the ballot unit at the same time. But our existing ballot units and control units were not like that. So then I'm assuming that is the reason. So what we came up with a solution looked like this. You see the ballot unit on the rightmost side, A, B, C, D, what is written there. And then you see the VVPAT in the middle. And then you see on the left side, you have what you called as your control unit. So why we did it? Because now the same wire which went from ballot unit to the control unit can be taken out from the control unit and connected to the VVPAT. So BU connects to the VVPAT. And VVPAT now acts as a ballot unit, for a control unit. And then from here, another wire goes to the control unit. So what was done? So in the next picture makes it clear. Ballot unit goes to the VVPAT, and VVPAT it goes to the control unit. So this was our design solution for introduction of VVPAT. I'm sorry for smiling, because it is unbelievable for me that we came out with a solution which cannot be called anything other than a jugaad. This is the pure jugaad, so that we can use the existing BU and CU by keeping something in between. So now, the VVPAT mimics a CU behavior for BU, because this is a previous BU which is only supposed to be connecting to the CU. And VVPAT mimics as a BU to the control unit. The vote flow, the vote which is flowing now, is from ballot unit to the VVPAT, and from the VVPAT to the control unit. And this picture is also from Election Commission's own Tamil Nadu CU PDF. So all the picture that I'm showing is, none of it is, I have not made. All of these are from Commission's own PDFs that are there from various states or Bell or ECL documents. So this is our design architecture solution that we did. So now the original question was, we don't know what is getting recorded in the control unit. That was our original question. The way we introduced our VVPAT, even right now, we don't know what is getting recorded in the control unit. Because ballot unit vote is sent from ballot unit to the VVPAT, and from the VVPAT, it goes to the control unit. So we know what is going from the BU to CU VVPAT because VVPAT prints the slip. But we don't know what is going from VVPAT to the control unit because it just remains the same. That is not what was supposed to be. Even in the Supreme Court direction, it was that what is getting registered in the control unit should be printed. It was not that what is getting printed should get registered. The sequence was something else. But the way we brought in, because we wanted to use existing BUs and CUs as it is, I assume, that is, I am not in an authoritative position to say that is the reason why we went ahead with this, but I can't think of any other reason to come out with such a design. So in between, that is what our position is. So BVPAT is right now sitting in between. Now, this itself has a lot of concern. There are multiple diagrams which shows how the connection is. Ballot unit to BVPAT and from BVPAT to CU. So CU is with the polling officer kept control unit, and the BVPAT and BU are usually kept in the compartment, in the cabinet. So the question now is, what is casting the vote to the control unit? Is it ballot unit or is it BVPAT? If you take these as black boxes, you know, we don't know what is inside, and commission has not revealed what is inside. If you take these as black boxes, BVPAT as a black box, BU as a black box, and the CU as a black box, now the vote is getting cast by the BVPAT, not by the ballot unit. If you take away the ballot unit also, right? If you take away the ballot unit also, technically it is possible to cast a vote to the control unit without any intervention. Now, this is our technological solution that we have come. Now, the question further that arises is that when is this symbol, you say this K or something, name, etc., details that are shown in this BVPAT, when is this getting uploaded onto the BVPAT? Somebody has to upload it, and at some level, some stage. And these are not physically uploadable. You can't type in, there is no place for you to type in. And there are symbols, like if you see, there are symbols. You can't type in this symbol. So these information has to be uploaded. And these information has also to be mapped, because it has to say that first number, the button one, is corresponding to this. That is why when you're pressing one, the candidate corresponding to one's name, you know, and the symbol will be printed, nothing else. So it has to be uploaded and it has to be mapped. Now, when is this done? That was one of the key questions that arose during the introduction of BVPAT. This can be only done after the candidates are known. Before not, that is not possible. And candidates are known and Form 7A is published. And that is a stage when it is actually done, and that is the stage of commissioning. Now, before commissioning, as we discussed earlier, certain steps are already done. That FLC was done, first level check in front of the political party representatives. The mock poll associated with the FLC was done. First level randomization was done as to which constituency these EVMs are going to. Second level randomization is done as to which booth these EVMs are going to. And now the Form 7A or the sequence of the candidates is also known. And at this stage, you also know when is the election date. So all this information is already available or is in the past. And it is at that time during the commissioning that we upload these name and the symbols onto BVPAT. How we do it? We use a laptop. So the Bell or the ECIL staff, they bring, so these are not secured laptops or anything kept in the strong room. They bring it from whenever they come, a day or two before the commissioning day. They come on the day of commissioning. So earlier, we were under strict direction not to allow any electronic device anywhere near commissioning room and, you know, first, second, third level security, blah, blah, blah. Right now, but it is said that they should be allowed to bring in certain devices. One is laptop, and the other is symbol loading units. So I'll come to that. So the laptops are brought in, and then in our case, internet, it had to be connected to the internet. The laptop had to be connected to the internet, to the election commission server, to download what is known as a symbol loading application. Now that is here, you know, creation of symbols. You're able to see this, right?
Yes.
Okay. So this is that symbol loading application. So they download whatever is this symbol loading application, either from some device, but normally because since they have to format their laptops, it is in their this thing. They download it from the commission server and onto the laptop by connecting it to the internet. Now, once they download this symbol loading application, they create a BVPAT sheet. And these are all from Bell documents. Bell document says that they create a BVPAT sheet and they have to enter the constituency number, constituency name, total number of candidates, etc., and the details of the candidates also, and create that replica of Form 7A. This sheet that we said, then electronic replica of that, the same VVPAT sheet has to be created. And once that is created onto the created on the laptop, now from the laptop, this particular presentation is on that. From the laptop, it is taken to the symbol loading unit. It says open the symbol loading unit for M3 VVPAT and PC laptop, select load VVPAT sheet and select the constituency name, etc., etc. And connect symbol loading unit to PC through the PC port marked on SLE with the 9-pin serial cable, BU cable. So you connect a 9-pin serial cable from the laptop. It's like I remember doing a lot of microcontroller programming and for robotics and stuff during our college days using these cables. So it is like that kind of a thing. From a laptop, they connect it and to the symbol loading unit first, and then the load symbols from PC is selected, and then it is all downloaded onto the symbol loading. Now, once it is downloaded onto the symbol loading unit, the next step is uploading these symbols from the symbol loading unit to the VVPAT. Now, why do we do that? Because we don't have those many laptops. Otherwise, we could have removed with this symbol loading units. But making so many laptops would have been very costly. So we again did a jugaad and said that, okay, let there be laptop and let there be another device called symbol loading unit, which is a very minimal USB. It's not a USB, it's an active device. So something of that sort in between, which is cheaper and mass produce that, So laptop, one laptop, 20 symbol loading units. And from those 20 symbol loading units, again, connected to the VVPAT using a 9-pin serial cable to all the VVPATs, 100 or 200 VVPATs which are there. Now, this is done at the time of commissioning. Now, this is where now an external connection is done to the VVPAT. And this is, for me, it is concerning because VVPAT is the one which is casting the vote to the control unit. VVPAT is casting the vote to the control unit. And it is to the VVPAT that now you are connecting an external device, which is not stored, secured, or anything. It is brought in and it is taken out. External device, and it is connected on around 15, 20 days before the commissioning. But at the time when both the stages of randomization is now irrelevant. Why? Because first randomization is done, second randomization is also already done. So both the randomization is prior to this external connection. So both becomes irrelevant, at least. If I know I have to do something, at this point of time. Similarly, first mock poll becomes irrelevant during the FLC because that is also done previously. It's like doing a computer scan and then connecting it to an internet. So the previous scan is almost, you can't rely entirely on that. So this is done, that is done. Now what we have is the candidate agnostic nature part. That is also not there. Why? Because now the machine knows when the vote is going from button one to this VVPAT that it is so-and-so candidate. If I know the symbol, I can even tell which party it is. If this is the symbol, let's say this is a hand or a lotus or something else, I can very well know. Party name is not input in here, but the symbols are there. So once you know the symbol, it's as much as good as they knowing which party the vote is going to. So the machine is now candidate aware. Very well aware as to candidate one is so-and-so, candidate two is so-and-so. And a VVPAT can technically know who has got the, which party has got the maximum vote at the time of voting itself, because it is printing each of these sheets. And it is also accessing a particular memory location to do that. So candidate agnostic nature gone, both stages of randomization gone, physical access, that security that we said that we don't allow anybody to connect anything to the machine is gone because now we are actually physically connecting a cable. The aspects of first mock poll and the FLC that was done, that is gone. The other argument of EVM being an unconnected standalone rudimentary device, as far as I understand, is also gone. Why? Because first, you look, this is the VVPAT machine. If you see this, you see that there is an IO, of course, a 9-pin serial, whatever is there, it is something is getting in input, something is getting output. It has a programmable memory, at least where I am able to, I'm not saying the program part or the firmware part, but it has a memory wherein I am able to load the names and symbols and et cetera, of the candidate. So there is a memory that is to manage. It has a printer. So there has to be a printer driver, et cetera, for it to print this information. It also has a light driver. It also has a timer. It also has an IR sensor. All this in this particular machine. So if you have a, consider this as a screen, this is pretty much like a well, a good computer, as good as a, it is not a, it is not just a counter that is adding +1, +1, +1 and keeping it there. No, it is far more beyond that. This is also not unconnected because it is getting connected to an external device. So that argument of being a one-time or a rudimentary or a unconnected, all those arguments are also gone. So now the whole commission's arguments, only two things are left. Technical security arguments are out. Physical security arguments are out. From the process safeguards, the randomization is done prior to the connection, external connection. The candidate agnostic nature is gone because the machine is now candidate aware. First mock poll is also out because it is done prior to the connection. Now what we have is two more mock polls. The first one that is done is immediately after this commissioning is done. You know, when commissioning is when you make all these three things connect together. We upload the symbols onto the VVPAT. We paste this paper onto the ballot unit. We set the candidate and we said, okay, everything is now working fine. This EVM is fine to just be placed to the booth. Now at that time, we do a mock poll. And when we do that mock poll, here, as I said, we take 5% of the EVMs and then we do a random 1,000 poll to be done, which should have been a good check, provided these two things which I found to be a little scary. One is the session information with the VVPAT. So it says here itself, this is again from Bell document. It says poll session information, if you look down, the session number starts from 0 to 99. With each power on, it gets incremented by 1. It is reset to 0 after uploading ballot paper symbols to VVPAT in 3 or after session number 99. So it is able to incrementally remember, if you switch it on, switch it off, that this is number session 1, session 2. And you can check it. If you are going to vote tomorrow in a constituency, there is a button that is accessible to every voter just behind the VVPAT. Go and just switch it off and switch it on. Okay. Then the next time the machine would run, it will say session 2, session 3, it will keep saying that. And you can also do a very interesting experiment to say that how this connection is correct or not, whether this is correct, what I'm saying. When a ballot, when you press a button, in the ballot unit and it comes to the, it gets shown in this VVPAT as this, what is called as K or whatever name symbol, it is supposed to hang there for 7 seconds. And after 7 seconds, there is a cutter and then it cuts and then it falls down. The way it is programmed is that the program isn't this from my, I tried at least 20, 30 times and every time it consistently behaved the exact same way. If it is if at the time of it falling down, this particular paper, if you switch off that button, which is behind this VVPAT machine, it's accessible to everybody. It is not covered also. If you switch it off, what will happen is this particular paper will get inserted inside this machine, this VVPAT box, but vote will not get registered in the control unit. So your ballot unit, you have pressed something, your VVPAT has printed the slip, but your control unit has not registered it till now. Why? Because the way it is designed is, it is supposed to completely fall down. There is an IR sensor or something that I suppose. Only after it completely falls down, it sends the symbol to the control unit to say that, yes, now go ahead. This is the vote that is done. You'll hear the key sound that comes after it. But the moment it is falling down, if you switch it off, it goes into a failsafe or whatever. It just shuts down. And very interestingly, afterwards, if you switch it on, the VVPAT, it will say, a separate slip will come, a small slip strip would come, saying that do not count this vote. Why? Because machine knows that it has not sent that vote to the VVPAT. So it will send a separate slip saying that do not count this vote. Now, why is it foolish? Because you do not know which vote to be not counted. This is a separate slip which is coming in. There might be 500 slips already inside that. And in that,
you're adding one small strip of a paper coming down and saying, do not count this vote. And so this I had asked the engineers there and demonstrated and also shown them and saying, how am I supposed to know which vote not to count? This is just a random, you know, paper that is coming in. But it also shows the dependency or the vote flow from ballot unit to the VVPAT and from the VVPAT to the control unit and how the VVPAT actually casts the vote after everything the VVPAT has done and then it is sent. Now, this is all black box analysis. Whatever is inside, unless the commission comes out and says, this is what goes on inside, you know, you can't counter, you can't agree or disagree. Now comes the, here what you know as a session information that I said, this particular, here also you should be able to see that, there is a little tight to see that. So here what you call as a session information, and there is also this after M2 version of the commission, this must be anybody who has gone to the election commission, PDF, this is one of the standard formats that they have. They have something called, if you look at the right side, they have something known as real time for time and date stamping of the key process. So the machine actually is time and date stamping each key press. That's what the commission also claims. And in fact, you can take out a sequential printout also from a control unit. The sequential printouts can be taken and even during FLC, it can be shown tell them that, okay, the first vote had gone to, you know, so-and-so, second vote had gone to so-and-so, third vote had gone to so-and-so. That level is also done. It is not just an aggregate candidate 100 votes, candidate 200-300 votes. No, you can actually go and take out a sequential printout saying that candidate one gave this vote to so-and-so. That is also possible in the EVM. And the sequential vote feature is also there. But here it also says that there is a real-time clock for time and date stamping key process there. This is slightly problematic for me as far as the second mock poll is concerned, because if you know the current date, today's date and time, or either through VVPAT session information or through the date and time information, and you also know the date of poll, you know that today is not date of poll. You know? So all that you need to do is that if not date of poll, don't do anything. So it becomes, that whole mock poll becomes kind of a, you know, it can be overcome, it can be bypassed. So these are questions that I'm asking myself also, that, you know, it is not possible for me to say that is foolproof, because a machine has information as today, and the person who is connecting, or the person who is, it need not be even the person who is aware and knowingly connecting it. When the person is connecting into the election commission server, it can be man in the middle, or it can be anything which is there on his laptop. He might also be not aware. So whoever is trying to influence at the time of commissioning, at that point of time, he has three key information already with him, which both this EVM is going, which, what is the sequence of the candidates in that constituency, that candidate one, two, three, who are these people? And three, when is the poll date? So all three information is available at the time of connecting VVPAT EVM to an external device. So if I know the poll date and if I know today's date, it is, of course, everybody here, I'm assuming that they are much more an expert in cybersecurity and even computer science programming, that it is nothing of a concern at all to overcome that. Then only thing that we left with is the last mock poll that we do on a poll day. That is also, you know, that is the most weak link, or the weakest link even in the pre-VVPAT EVM process, because it pre-decided that it is going to be 50 votes or 60 votes, you know, around 50 votes. Once you know that it is 50 votes, it is so very easy to overcome that anything. You just need to ignore that, you know, when count more than 50, start doing, that is it. So you don't have to do anything else. So this surrender, whatever the commission itself claimed were to be the security features of our EVM, the introduction and the way we introduced EVM surrendered all, not one, all the processes, and you will not find a single argument for EVM security other than the ones that I mentioned. It covers the entire thing. And all of it has been surrendered by the introduction of the way we introduced. I'm not against VVPAT. I would like to call it that. But the way we introduced it, it surrendered. Now, VVPAT, the way it was supposed to come, had two key aspects. I'm sure Professor Subhashish Banerjee must have said about it. That is the verifiability of the vote at the time, the individual verifiability at the time of voting, and public auditability at the time of counting. You know, the voter verifiable paper audit trail. There also we did Jugaad. our verifiability is not an active verifiability. The voter does not have any agency to verify whether what I pressed is what is getting printed. He or she is supposed to, you know, I pressed here and I looked somewhere, for I did not know where to look. It must have gone down, or let's say I programmed the VVPAT in a way that, hypothetically, that it does not even wait for 7 seconds. It just falls down, okay? Or the light doesn't work, or whatever things that happen in chat. These are all, you know, assuming it can be programmed. Let's assume one of it happens and I fail to notice the paper that went inside. I have not verified it, you know? So the current process does not ensure that the voter has verified the vote. That is again a concern. It is like you verify, okay. You don't verify, then also okay. We will take whatever, you know, is getting printed. We assume that you have verified it. It is your job if you don't. So that paradigm also is one compromising from a VVPAT point of view, because we are not verifying it. Second thing, let's assume, okay, now I have a concern. Boss, this is not, I saw that it is going to somebody else. Or I can say that I did not see, it just fell down. It did not wait for that much time. Or I'm not sure whether I saw it correctly. So you can go, the legal framework right now says I can go to the presiding officer, file a complaint, and then go and get a test vote. And a test vote is a transparent vote, wherein in the presence of everybody, I am allowed to vote and show, you know, whether it will be seen whether it has come correctly or not. Now, if it is correct, if it has come correctly, then the person can be prosecuted and fined and even jailed. You know, it can be prosecuted and fined. The fine is definitely there, you know, in the rule itself. So here comes the where the election process is punishing the voter for doubting the machine. You know, the whole exercise is supposed to be the, you know, an exercise, sovereign exercise of the voter. But our election legal framework, not only our technological framework is enabling or ensuring verifiability, our legal framework is actively discouraging verifiability and says that that is not done. You know, if you unnecessarily come and here make a sort of a thing, then you can be prosecuted, you can be fined, whatever. So nobody bothers to do all that. Most of the time they just press and then they look here, and then many of them just walk out. And here, again, verifiability comes. And the thing is, other thing is, here we assume, this test vote paradigm assumes that any manipulation will be a consecutive one. You know, it will be a continuous one. That if something is done on this vote, it will be done necessarily, it will be done on the next one also. Which again, I find to be, a naive assumption. I don't think that is a correct assumption. Because nobody is going to do such a thing. You know, they might randomly take one in, you know, whichever number to take 7th, 9th, 11th, something like that. Or that is not random, went into an odd sequence. But something like that, if you want to do. And if the consecutive one is not, then 100% the person will be proved to be wrong and he can be prosecuted for it. So the current verifiability paradigm technologically does not ensure verifiability. It only allows for passive verifiability. Legal framework discourages verifiability, and the whole thing, even if it allow, you know, we go ahead with that argument also, then also only thing it allows for is a consecutive, you know, what is the next vote that has been. It is not possible for the voter to verify what he voted actually, and the test vote is actually discarded at the time of one vote is reduced, because it is taken down as test vote caster for so-and-so candidate one. So when it is counted, that test vote is reduced from the count of the candidates at that point of time. Same thing comes with the auditing part. I'm sure this again I'm repeating. But every election to a constituency is an independent event. And if at all statistically you have to find out a sample, the right sample to go ahead with it, you should take the population of that particular constituency to decide upon the sample size. So the population size cannot be the 10 lakh booths that we have across the country. The elections can happen in a bipol in a particular constituency. Election can happen in a Lok Sabha constituency. Election can happen in entire state. Election can happen to the entire country. So, but every level and every election is important, and every election should meet the, you know, characteristic of the, and somebody is drawing something. Yeah. Sorry. So, at at every election also, these sampling requirements, statistically significant sampling, has to be met with, which is again unfortunately not the case that we have. Like, we had that example in Bengal wherein a few people came out and said we voted for them, it went for somebody else. Now, they could have been saying truth, they could have been saying lie. But the fact is, we have no way to verify. We have no way to tell whether they were lying or whether they were saying the truth. And that is the limitation of our current regime when it comes to VVPAT. We don't ensure verifiability, and we don't do adequate auditing also. Statistically, what is the hypergeometric distribution, et cetera, et cetera. I think, you know, somebody else would be the best person to comment on it. So while we surrendered all the arguments that we had for the pre-VVPAT, we also did not benefit from a true VVPAT, truly verifiable VVPAT design. That has been my concern with respect to the shift to the VVPAT. And that is why post 2019 or during those 2019 elections, I started raising these questions, and which has been continuing for a while now. I have returned these questions to the Election Commission also. Unfortunately, our framework is such that the same technical expert committee who has designed the EVMs are the ones who will also review any questions raised. Everything is the same. And there are not even two experts from the same field in that. It's like one expert from each field. So nobody can counter on a view. I think in a basic tester, in a two-person company also, there would be a developer and a tester. So, but we don't have that kind of a framework where an independent body where I can raise these questions and expect to get an answer. So that is from EVM, VVPAT, and my concerns with respect to the process point of view. This is again to say, not to say elections are hacked. That will be very irresponsible to say that elections are hacked, this election was hacked, this was not hacked, that was hacked. That will be very irresponsible to say X or Y elections are hacked. No. It is to say that certain, a window is open, and you are saying that the window is open. You are not saying somebody has stolen something. If you are seeing that window is open, it is your duty to say that the window is open. Please close it, or find out why is it open, or is there a different way to do it. If you wait for this to happen, there are two things. As I said, the change that can come in due to this changes in the software is undetectable. You can't detect. And if you can't detect, there is no way you can say whether it was hacked or not hacked. One. Two, at any point of time, if there is a change that might come in, that change would be an irreparable change, loss. It is not that you can go back after that. Let's assume it sometime in the future, because of this non-vulnerability, something happens. And this is not a question of BJP or Congress, or that is least of the worry. I think we should assume that our political parties are integral enough not to do such things. But at the same time, there are also national security arguments involved. Why are we assuming that other nations are not involved in influencing our elections? Why do we think so? Do we consider ourselves as not important enough that our elections, even small countries' elections, are attempted to be influenced? Why do we consider that ours is not an important election enough to be important enough to be influenced? And if that is the case, again, those questions, the national security arguments would again come to the way forward. That is, the whether it is a blockchain or with a public blockchain, or we have our own blockchain, whatever is the way forward with it. And that is from my side on the EVM. I think some of the questions with respect to any of this I can take. I think I took a long time. Sorry for that.
No, I think this has been quite illuminating in terms of raising questions and showing where to raise questions. Because that's the key, right? It is important for us to strive to find independent forums in which to find answers to the question, do the process and all of that. But having the questions out and having this conversation is open. I think there are questions from YouTube which have been queued up, and there are questions over here in the chat as well. Suman, would you like to just go through the questions as you have them?
Yes, I will, but I will be a bit selfish and put a question of mine first. Let's assume a very simple voting machine, okay, where all we have is this button. And when you press a button, one bit gets turned on, and then there is this infinite strip of bits, okay? So I go in, cast a vote, and you know the bit changes to one. Then you go in and you vote for the other candidate, assuming there are only two candidates. You vote for the other candidate and the bit goes to zero. And you know the voting process goes so on and so forth. Now my question is, even with such a simple machine, if I know the order in which voters went into the voting booth, I will be able to figure out who voted for which candidate?
Yeah, in fact, you can. That's what I said. You can, if you go to the documents of FLC and try to search FLC and SQL print out, okay? Just search these two terms on Google. You will find that the EVM can actually give you a sequential printout that who was, which first vote went to whom, second vote went to whom, third vote went to him. So that is there in the machine. And you also have a, you know, voter, you know, 17A. That is, you know, register of voters, wherein you write down as to vote number one was so and so. You don't write the vote went to whom, but you write who was the first voter. So you have the second voter, you have the third. So you have a list of registers, and you also have a sequence of votes. And that, if you have, then of course, like there is nothing. But the thing is, we don't. This form 17A and even the sequential printouts are only supposed to be taken out of a. Taken out of the EVM or the form 17A out of a strong room only on an election petition and upon the direction of a high court. That is the direction. So it will be a false statement to say that it is not possible. It is possible, very much possible. But the safeguard is more administrative in this regard, that form 17A is kept in. So you can argue that form 17A, before submitting it to the strong room, somebody else can keep another copy in the booth itself, or the polling agent can have their own copy, you know, not just the person who is presiding officer or the polling officer who is doing, somebody, the polling agent can also keep that who came one, first, second, third, etc. So the 17A copies can be done, but the sequential printout is only supposed to be done upon a direction from the on an election petition from the High Court.
Now, I understand that the votes are stored in the control unit, not the ballot unit, right? And I think this was a question that Yogesh had probably. So now, if the ballot unit, let's say you voted and the ballot unit goes, and you know, in the middle of a voting process, a ballot unit malfunctions, it will probably be taken to Bell, right? And there the engineers can figure out the memory layout, right? So until and unless order in which
once the EVMs are combined in Bell, you know, in BU and CU, ballot unit and control unit, if there is any malfunction in any of it, either of it, you don't replace one, okay? You replace both. What you do is,
okay,
you save, let's say, it happens after 200 votes, okay? So now if it's happening after 200 votes, you secure that 200 votes because it is already there. You close the control unit or whatever the position it is, and you bring in a new BU and a CU and continue with the voting, you know, from 201 onwards. And
what happens if the control unit goes bust?
Control units goes bust. If that is the case, then, you know, if it goes beyond any, like if it gets fire or something like that, or push or something, then it has to be, the votes have to be recast, you know, it has to be done again. Otherwise, if it is any other malfunction, it is just closed and it is kept. So there are Bell ECIL staff who are associated with each section officers in this thing. So whenever such instances come, they go and see, okay, this is now not possible to continue, keep it aside and go ahead with the next. But whereas if there is a replacement for VVPAT, here you don't replace all three. Here you only replace, if there is a malfunction with a VVPAT, you replace that VVPAT and add the other VVPAT. That is because VVPATs were known for a lot of malfunctions. You know, had a very high malfunction rate initially, close to 10% or something.
Okay, Taha Ali has a fantastic question. he's asking, is there any encryption or crypto being used in these machines at any stage? From what little I've read, it seems they introduced encryption in the EVMs in the last 2-3 years, but I can't seem to find any literature on what it's being used for, how and why.
Yeah, see, this is what the, I don't know, I may not share anything. One second. So yeah, this is what the secure design features the commission claims. Right, this is all, right? So commission does not claim anything else. It's a dynamic coding of key press. It is a, this is not possible, real-time stamping. And it also says there are certain fail-safe communication mechanisms that if you connect it to something else, then it will not. I'm not an expert from the inside of a Bell. I'm not a Bell engineer or design engineer. Who can say that, okay, this is the cryptographic element that is there involved in this or it is not there. I don't, in my understanding limited, I don't think there is any cryptography involved at this stage in our any of the EVMs.
Okay, so Sabir HH has a very interesting question. He's asking, how is the data saved? I saw one video that all the votes are stored on Excel sheets on Windows computers with the operators in the strong room where they collect the data from each EVM computer. Is this correct?
No, absolutely not. This is stored in the control unit itself. You know, whatever is the memory that is there in the control unit, that is in the electronic form and as paper slips inside the VVPAT. Okay, that is there inside the VVPAT, those papers. So in paper form, it is there in the VVPAT box. And in electronic form, it is in the memory of the control unit. Now here actually comes a very interesting question. What is a vote? Is it the paper or is it the vote that is registered in the control unit? You know, there are now two representations of your one expression. You know, your expression of vote of casting to X or Y candidate is now stored in two different forms. One in the form of paper and the other in the form of electronic data. Now, what constitutes legally a vote is not settled there yet. We don't know. Commission has given that if there is a discrepancy between the control unit, the vote that is registered in the control unit, and the vote that is in the paper that is kept in the VVPAT, then the VVPAT is the one which should take precedence, right? If the, let's say it says 100 and the, we could count 101, then in the result sheet, we are supposed to update it as 101. That means VVPAT sheet paper slips have the preference or the priority. Now that creates another issue because if that is the case, then VVPAT slip becomes your vote. And if VVPAT slip is your vote, then you have to count every vote. You can't count a representative of the vote. You have to count all the votes. And then again, this question comes. So no, it is not saved in any Excel sheet. It is kept on that counting day in front of every political parties, etc. It is opened, the strong rooms are opened. One by one, in there are some 15 counting tables, 15, 16, depending upon the thing, it is kept. And one by one, it is kept. It is opened from that box. The serial number is supposed to be shown to the counting agents. And then it is, total number of results, candidates, etc. are shown. And then from there, you take it down to a paper, okay? On the paper, then you have a blackboard also. On the blackboard also, it is written. Okay, so for every constituency, it is done in a single place. So the candidates are also sitting there. So in the blackboard, it is written. Candidate one, these many votes, candidate two, every round, after every round. On a paper also, it is written. And also on the computer, some as you said, in an Excel sheet or computer, it is formed. Now that is just for data filing purpose. The data is stored in the control unit. The data is actually shown in terms of blackboard right now there itself on the paper and taken, you take the signature of the agents also there who are there, that it has been there, that it is to their satisfaction. And then it is kept in the and finally, along with the signature of the observer, it is compiled into a result sheet and certificate of election is made and certificate of election and result sheet is transferred to the sent physical papers and also electronically it is sent to the election commission. So at no stage it is stored as Excel.
Right, one follow-up question. So even on the ballot unit, the votes are probably stored in an EEPROM, right? Erasable Programmable Read-Only Memory.
I don't think so. A ballot unit is just a...
I mean the control unit. Now, on the control unit, that EEPROM memory layout will not be randomized, right? So votes will be recorded as they arrive.
I don't think there is any inside randomization that is happening within a control unit.
So that is a potential vulnerability, because that would allow an adversary to figure out the sequence.
No, that's what I'm saying. You can actually, you are assuming from once you get access to it, then you might be able to find out as to how. But otherwise, a sequential printout itself is possible. So you can just take it.
Yes. No, I was thinking about pre-VVPAT days.
No, even this, I'm talking about pre-VVPAT only.
Okay. So there was this.
Yes. Even before the VVPAT itself, if you find out the documents, you'll find that a simple printout is possible to be done of a sequential in a sequential mode.
Okay. Very technical number of questions. Number of questions, actually. Oh my god, I don't even know where to start. Okay,
I don't know if Shankarshan or Zainab, they all agree, because some of them are also equally knowledgeable in the discussion group. At least they can also pitch in and give their views who are there on Zoom. No.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it doesn't necessarily need to be questions directed at you. I think you have firsthand insights, but there obviously are others who are equally... There's a conversation happening on the Zoom chat, so that's one thing. But the thing is that the conversation is moving fast, and questions are coming hot and heavy at this point. So it's very interesting.
Yeah, I'm also unable to actually... I'm supposed to answer, then I'm unable to catch up with the discussion that is going on the chat. Okay, fine. So I'll just close the chat then. Okay.
No, it's okay. I think we are trying to answer some of these questions.
Hey, sorry. I'm talking to Gokul in the chat. Gokul, please, no advanced technology. Kiran is not in the chat for that.
Hey, Kiran. Hi.
Hey.
So, Kiran, I was saying this is quite an alarming situation, right? So, this is getting us to an archaic... system where the entire voting becomes a farce, right? This is something people like David Crom has anticipated, this kind of a mockery of election systems if we use primitive technology stack. This is really a concern. For example, we are getting into an era where massive computers, big data systems can overthrow the kind of information systems, because the moment you have all this data, the electronic data coming from the VVPAT machines using software defined radios. Nowadays we are seeing we can hijack a MH370, you can hijack a plane, then how is it difficult to hijack an electronic voting machine? It's not a big deal.
Yeah, but in this case, I think actually that modern technology is more vulnerable, not less.
Exactly.
Because the attack surface has not been sufficiently studied. Whereas
exactly.
To primitive technology...
Like Kannan said correctly, we need to randomize it using differential privacy. Scrambling has to be done, if at all.
Differential privacy is not yet in production use in any significant system, because nobody's...
It was proposed in
the
US, It was proposed
Okay, so sorry, I'm butting through. But differential privacy in this particular case would be very problematic, given that elections have been decided by a margin of a single vote, number one.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, I think the more appropriate solution would be to look at homomorphic encryption. But the problem is, we're still about 5 to 10 years away from that kind of technology.
Absolutely.
And right now it's kind of slow.
Yeah. And homomorphic encryption with a multi-party computation system would be good. Because, if you trust a single... what I was saying is homomorphic encryption with a multi-party computation would be beneficial than a single machine computing the final outcome. Because, you know, when you have a centralized system, a central machine deciding the outcome, there is always a risk that somebody can do a man-in-the-middle attack or civil attack or any Byzantine attack. That's the fact of the matter.
And I mean, I would say yes. And the interesting bit is we are still, and you know, all these attacks that you're talking about, they're totally, I mean,
it has
totally doable. No, totally doable. And on traditional, and I'm talking about
it has already happened in US elections. Right. It has been done multiple times.
Now I'm talking about things that cryptographers these days are working on, and that's trying to build a post-quantum secure e-voting system. So essentially, you know,
yeah,
change the kind of
quantum system we have. Know, people can hack it for election bonds. That is the funny part. Tomorrow, when elections will get monetized in India, you're now seeing election bonds coming in the market, right? Just for profiteering in the election bond market, people would trade with your votes. So the entire vote will become a mockery. That's what's going to happen. You know what? When this Indian election will be the largest election bond in the world. Just imagine what will happen if our election bond market will be open to international hedge funds. What will happen is it will be floated on future trading. And then when then the stakes are high, this will be a funny scenario. You know what?
All right. So I'm going to suggest that we come back to this topic, but we'll walk through some of the questions that are there.
Sorry. Probably we can. I tried to hijack the conversation. Sorry, Kannan.
It is interesting to know, but at the same time, we have to be a little cautious in the sense that elections are not just a technocratic exercise that are, to be satisfactory to a people who have privilege or knowledge or understanding about various techniques or various
processes. Exactly. Yeah, that's for the common man. Yes. The last of the men. Of the men. I mean the people. Sorry for being gender sensitive.
Yeah. No. That is the last. It is very, very, very much important that the elections remain what it is. It is actually the transfer of sovereignty from an individual to a government, saying that yes, you are, and that has to be a fully aware exercise for that person who is exercising that vote. He's doing that, and he should know. I think that was what the German Constitutional Court also commented when it came out with that judgment, saying that for that person should know, and it should be verifiable to him or her that this is what I voted, and this is where it went, and that is how it got counted, and he or she got elected to govern on my behalf. So that is something again that should be kept, because we cannot take away the whole election process to a project mode. How to find a solution to it which is technically acceptable? No, we have to find a process that is technically acceptable and at the same time democratically acceptable. It is democratically accountable, and it is also transparent to everyone.
Exactly. Anand, thank you for bringing up the point, because this transparency is very much required. At the end of the day, the audit trail, without disclosing the privacy of the individuals, instead of like, you don't need to disclose it, there should be a differential disclosure of the summary of the vote from each polling booth, so that at the end of it, it is just like we are letting people to do predictions, right? Predictions of exit polls, and then pre-exit poll, right? Before the event, before the poll. Why don't we have the summary of the elections data, selective disclosure, through using, again, like we were saying, differential privacy, and multi-party computation cannot be used for counting the result, but at least we can give the aggregate using, there are protocols like multi-party computation, which can be used so that if in a particular country or when we have a panchayat election or an election happening in a state, the aggregate of all the stations, for example, if there are 10 polling booths in a particular panchayat, the outcome of the summary of that could be disclosed that day itself, so that there is no scope for hacking later. You can't change the number of votes. You can, so the summary, once it is out there in the public, that's how we get the accountability, right? What do you say about this suggestion?
No, again, I have myself here and in all the talks refrained from giving any suggestion as a solution for one reason, that I don't agree with the way we have come so far.
Right.
Come so far in elections because it was always a closed process, you know, it was not a peer-reviewed process. It was not a peer-reviewed process, let's say, that this is how the EVM should be. And nobody commented on it, nobody, there was no, you know, the same set of people designed, same set of people.
Reviewed. It is now in the hand of a selective few in IIT, the professors. That's really dangerous.
Yeah, and
I mean,
I'm not saying dangerous that it is with the IIT professors, but it has to be, in any science, there is an established process by now. And if we are looking for a scientific or a technological solution to this problem, then also we should, I think, at this point of time, we should not.
This should be broad-based dialogue, right, Kanan? Like it should be brought into the public.
I just wanted to point out a couple of things over here. One, today's session has been designed to raise the questions. But this is also tied into the project that we have where we gather the evidence as submissions and just like what you're suggesting, that there are alternatives that need to be explored, scientific approaches that need to be taken, and they need to be assessed with the aim of making it more explainable and more transparent. So I think what I
would... where we can continue this conversation?
Absolutely. I'll post the link, or Kiran post the link on the chat and then separately, and we can continue this, because this eventually will go down the path of where it becomes fascinating enough and we'll just miss out on a few other questions. So I'm going to queue up the questions that have happened.
I'll listen in the following meeting. Please let me, I'll be happy to continue the conversation in the mailing list.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. So Sameer, thank you for your patience. I'll queue you up and you can have a go at your question.
Okay. So, all right. So before
Please go on.
No, I was just trying to find your question actually.
Okay. All of us are here and we are going to come up with a solution at some point, I hope, because there's going to be a lot of discussion, but the discussions can keep on going. At some point, when we are thinking about solution, we should not just think about that it has to be transparent. Yes, I understand. But it has to also be agreeable and understandable by the last person. So any technological solution, whether it is EVMs or any other solution that we might come up, which is like super hack proof and all of that, would eventually, the question is that how are we going to explain that this is how it works, and the last man in India who's there voting in a village would understand. So does EC have this thing in mind? Do they believe that everyone should agree to such a system? What is your thought, Kanan sir? And that is my question.
That has been one of the key issue, that it has been a top driven process and administratively driven process, that certain things like ballot papers had certain issues. Ballot papers were the most transparent, and if I'm not wrong, ballot papers, voting through ballot papers have been there since like some 100 BC or something, and you know, this kind of voting, so it has like a 2000 year people have agreed on that kind of voting for forever. But it had certain issues like ballot stuffing, booth capturing, etc., which came in. And at the same time, the issue about, it was not just that, it was about the managing the whole thing was also becoming a huge exercise in itself, the paper, the ballot boxes, all those stuff. So electronic voting machine in a way came out as a administrative solution to it. Ideally, electronic voting machine should have come as a correctness solution. Whereas I believe it came to our process as an efficient solution, as a speedy solution, you know, the way it's a more simplified solution. And that is why it has always been take a decision and then convince the public that it is done. And it is also trust-based. It is not verifiable. The commission is not saying, when the VVPAT was not there, commission was not saying that every voter can verify. No. The commission is saying, your district magistrate or the SDM or some of the political party representatives, they are the key stakeholders. It's not the voter. They can verify. And they can verify not at the time of voting, but they can verify during a pre-voting scenarios, mock polls. And since they verified, you trust them. And since the machine has since then been only with the administration, and since you trust the administration, you trust the process altogether. So it is a custody chain. It is a trust-based process. It was not a verification-based or whether you agree with it or not. And that has been, that is also what you call reflective of our administration style and all, which has been a top-driven, we say you do, kind of an administration process. But this has caused a bit of big concerns, because in every election, you will find there will be a lot of people who are convinced that the election has been hacked, because there is no way to prove to them that it has not been hacked. You know, I think there was a wonderful paper by, you know, and it is always said also, election is not about finding the winning candidate. It is about convincing the losing candidates, right? It is about convincing the losing candidates that the person who won the election has won through a fair and free and fair means. That is all process. That is why we all agree, right? There is, it's like a game. There is a referee that we agree to. So this process then becomes a little confusing when we introduce more and more such technology. And whether it becomes agreeable or not. A lot of people are now concerned with the blockchain because a lot of people don't understand. And when something as fundamental in a democracy as voting becomes a mystery, right? When it becomes not an understanding aspect, you know, you can't comprehend, it becomes incomprehensible for a voter. And that is the only time in Indian democracy where a voter is actually participating in democracy. Every other time, he's just a recipient of something. Either it is a lati or it is a ration rice, but he's a recipient, you know, either way. But it's the only time when he actively participates in the democratic process. And now that process is also slowly getting out of the comprehension of a person. So that's definitely needs to be concern to the Election Commission. And I'm sure these discussions will also help, because see, these questions when I raise are of certain relevance. When the technical experts, the, you know, you have worked in cybersecurity and all those, when you raise these questions, it has a slightly more acceptability. When a random person is just saying elections are hacked, it goes to the realm of conspiracy theory. So it depends on the amount of information and justification with which you are saying the same thing. It all could be the same thing. You know, ye to hack ho sakta hai. Anybody can say that. And then it is just a wild theory. Somebody say this is how it can be hacked. Then it becomes, oh yes, that is a good. Then you say, oh, with computer theory, etc., this, you know, this is the issue. Okay, then that becomes another level of concern. So we need to guide this discussion into what it is and what it is not. You know, what are the vulnerable points, how it is vulnerable, rather than making it into a wild hack ho gaya type of a theory. Into a, because even if it doesn't change, ultimately I think it is not a question about electronic voting machine itself, right? The thing is, if you don't trust the process, then you don't trust the machine institution. If you don't trust the institution, then you don't trust elections itself. When you don't trust elections, then it is chaos, you know, then it is anarchy, then it becomes very difficult to be in a functioning democracy. So how to guide these discussions to a process oriented rather than result oriented concerns, that is, I think, more important. Yahan pe ye jeet gaya isliye EVM has been hacked, there they lost, that is why EVM has not been hacked. From there to say these are the issues with the current process, how do we address it, how do we move forward?
Right. So I'll take a couple more questions. One is from Yogesh, and he asks that do not count slips, do they have the serial number of the cancelled vote?
What do they mean? What do you mean by cancelled votes?
So, for example, let's say you say that if a paper doesn't, if the VVPAT paper slip does not fall properly, then the machine comes up with another slip that says don't count the vote, right?
Yeah. No, there are no serial numbers.
Oh, okay, it's just a piece of paper that says don't count the vote.
Yeah, it's just a piece of water says do not count this vote. We have no idea what vote is not to be counted. I don't know who comes up with such solutions.
It could have just put in the serial number, right?
No, you can't, right? Because then whenever you're counting, you know whose vote it is. So VVPAT has the serial number on the VVPAT slip is not of the vote. It is of the VVPAT machine. Okay? You see that serial number, okay. Right?
Right.
That serial number is not of the vote. That serial number is the serial number of the machine. The session is every time you on it and off. Otherwise, it is just just the board name, serial, the candidate name.
Absolutely. One is to one mapping happens, right?
So the slip that comes after if you do this is just a random slip. Ideally, the scenario in which I think the design would have happened is it gets stuck or something. It does not come completely. Mm. And in that time, along with it itself, the next thing will come. Along with that only, do not count this board. So it is effectively hanging together, right? Do not count this.
I see.
But if you are smart enough to switch it off after it comes down, then a separate slip just comes down saying that do not count this vote without any attachment to which vote is not to be counted. It is just a random slip that comes out. For me, that was not important. For me, the important thing was that there is a stop of vote flow at VVPAT. It is stopped, it is stored, and then it is sent to the control unit. That was actually a little alarming for me.
So that violates your recorded as cast assumption.
Yeah. That brings us back to the exact same question as before.
Right. So one more question from Akshay Dinesh, and he says, can we get rid of the control unit altogether?
That's an interesting question, actually. I was also curious to answer that. There are many ways to these people are saying that in US there are you print, so they use the machines to get something printed and then you cast it inside a booth. Then there are other options which are saying that instead of showing right now we have a VVPAT, so instead of just it being there and falling down, can we print and give it to in the hand of a voter? So instead of it going inside that box itself, let it come out. Mm-hmm. So I can take it out, see it, and then put it in a ballot box. That is, and then you can see you also, and you can audit it with this kind of a counter. And in fact, if you look at VVPAT sheet, it already has an OMR counting enabled kind of a thing. You see that. So you see on the left, right, those dot kind of things on the serial thing. So that is supposed to be for a OMR enabler, count enabling thing. So that it is not that that was not planned for. So if it is taken out and it is given, then the issue is about his concern is also about this exact thing, verifiability. And verifiability can be ensured through this. Then people would ask, can't then there be the exact same? Somebody can print it from somewhere else, buy only from here, and then put it inside, So then another set of questions will start coming from there. So another way to look at it is, let the EVM be there, let the control unit be there, let it be recording it as it is right now, but let the VVPAT give the vote printed to the voter so that he can take it out and then cast in a ballot box, so that it becomes both the things are there. The voter vote is there electronically stored in the control unit, and also printed paper is stored in the ballot paper, and also now with a full verifiability asset. So there are multiple ways. Why I'm slightly hesitating to discuss various options, including blockchain, etc., is that yes, there definitely has to be, but it cannot be as a governmental recommendation that let it be done. If at all it has to come, it has to be written by somebody as this is my solution. In a peer-reviewed journal, it has to be countered, it has to be criticized, across, and then we should come to nothing will be a perfect solution. We all understand that. Nothing will be a perfect solution. But understanding the vulnerabilities and saying that, this is where we need to keep a watch. Okay, here we have issues. here we will have our administrative and process safeguards, because this is a concern for us. That is something we can do. Other than that, otherwise we can all discuss, give so many solutions. There are a lot of people in every discussion. We all are innovative people. So we all have our own solutions to the things. But this is actually something what Akshay has suggested is actually something that is being used in many states. And in fact, one of the senior politicians in India also suggested the exact thing. Why can't we do this in India? So maybe that might be the way that we'll be going forward. We don't know.
It's 6 o'clock.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because...
Is it 6 o'clock?
Yeah, the 6 o'clock thingy. I think it's the Zoom setting. It keeps on every hour on the hour. It keeps on reminding, which is very handy actually. Okay. When you're having a session, that you get to know that you have been having this for quite a while. I think the important thing is to realize that quite a bit of the problems that we often get into is also originating from an anxiety to solve things. There's a solutionism thing that goes on, especially when you're in a room full of technology savvy people. And I think we started off this project with the idea that the solution should arise from a good understanding of the problem space first. What are we trying to address? And then try and do proper assessment of available solutions and paths rather than just picking arbitrarily one and then sticking to it without allowing a general public consultation. So, but since we are kind of wrapping up to perhaps what is going to be the end of the session, I have a few interesting comments that I noticed on chat that I'm going to pick up, and let's see how that goes. And some of them are directed to you, Kannan, so you might be actually very interested. Bijaka, there are two comments from Bijaka. One is obviously that there's a larger discussion around and a long history of critique around the faith placed on instrumental systems in the classic liberal conception of it. I agree with this. I think this has been a driving force in a whole bunch of things. But the question that I found very interesting is slightly up there, and I have to, since I scroll down, yeah, there it is. As a visible critic, how long do you think that you'll be able to resist the wrath of a retributive state? And it's an interesting question in many ways. It kind of resonates across a whole bunch of us as participating in conversations. So let's hear how you respond to this.
State is not the country. I am speaking in my country, right? So if I don't speak up in my country, where do I speak? If I don't feel free in my own country, and I'm not, the whole point of having your own free, independent country is that you should be able to speak up your mind. And I'm not bothered. There are FIRs. I have been arrested, detained, whatever. So that goes. I was DIG prisons also at a time, and I was very much looking at being inside a prison also. And in fact, even now there are two FIRs going on. So, but that is okay. I think I'm not particularly bothered. Sorry?
No, that's unbelievable, Kannan. We didn't know that. We really see your public face.
So that is what there is, of course, a consequence to your decisions and to your the question is whether you act upon on consequences or you act upon your conscience. So I think I can't speak up in, I can't go and
conscience precedes consequence. It's all about conscience.
Yeah. So
yeah, so, conscience and consciousness.
Yeah. So I think that is, so are you prepared for what has happened with Professor Anand Teltumbe? I think they all might have also been equally convinced about what they are saying. It is not that they were not bothered. It is not that they expected everything to go the way they wanted it. No, they are raising questions because they believe in what they're saying. And that is all I believe, but things would change. Many a times what happens is we try to assess everything from a very narrow historical framework of 2 years, 5 years, 6 years, 10 years, and then try to see our position vis-a-vis that 5-10 years time frame. That is not, if that was the way people fought independence, we wouldn't have got our independence. You know, that is not, you know, there was a whole Dandi March that happened that everyone remembers, but everybody forgets that Salto was never repealed because of that Dandi March, right? So we remember the struggle. Salt law was never repealed, it continued, but independence came. So that is also, I think, we need to analyze and assess things in a larger time frame. That is my belief, not to be, you know.
I think that's a very pertinent way of putting it, because there is, like I said, there is always this anxiety and tension and dynamic tension to be able to address situations at hand. But more often than not, situations take their own time and it requires constant presence, participation, and being able to engage effectively. So I think I'll ask Shuman if there are any other questions that he wants to queue up, or else we are going to sort of gently land this down to a close. Stop the live stream and all of that and do our housekeeping stuff. Shuman, do you have questions that you wanted to bring up?
Right. So one question I personally have had for a while is, so during the design or review phase for, before we started VVPATHS, were there any cryptographers that you consulted with, or do you think there was this discussion around secure protocol to be used?
No, actually, I don't know. I remember 2014 elections, there were 8 parliamentary constituencies, and it's wrong to say 8 parliamentary constituencies, 8 assembly constituencies within 8, you know, 1 assembly constituency within 8 parliamentary constituencies. So if there are 5-6 in each parliamentary constituency, 1 AC each. That is the first time there was a New Delhi, I remember this pilot being done, but that was all like a design. VVPAT had to be introduced. Somebody proposed it in a political party meeting. I think it was a committee led by Chandrababu Naidu or somebody from a few political parties. And then Election Commission agreed to review it. And then we had a technical expert committee by that time. And that technical expert committee looked into it, came up with a solution. Probably with the help of I don't know who, and then that's it. We have been doing it with VVPAT. So that is another main concern. You know, the institutional framework at coming, you know, in coming up with solutions, that is equally important as solutions itself, because otherwise we get stuck and we get overly defensive about it. You know, it's like right now it's difficult to question EVM because for a lot of people, EVM is their candidate. It is not the candidate. EVM is the candidate to be defended. Nobody can question EVM. So it becomes very difficult. I asked this question, boss, is EVM your candidate? It's just a process. Try to understand the process, ask the question. But we become overly defensive about that process, assuming that somebody who's questioning EVM is trying to question the existing government or the previous election. That way we wouldn't even come here, you know. That way in 2014 when VVPAT was introduced, by that we should have said that 2009 and 2004 elections with respect to EVMs were actually false, you know. That is why we came to a VVPAT, because it was an introduction to addition to something else which existed, right? So that should have mean there was something flawed. But that is not how progress happens. That is not how improvements happen. So this being overly defensive about whatever is today there is also hampering our progress when it comes to election. 2, not having a proper institutional framework in seeking responses, coming out with solutions, you know, and not even having my biggest concern is it's a technological solution and we don't even have 1 paper to study and say that this is what it is. And that shows a lot about the trust-based processes that we rely on. I don't think that is a sustainable thing. So, but I don't know, to just cut your answer short, that is that I don't know whether any cryptographer was consulted in the process. I think, but this is the last question, right? We will stop this question.
Yeah, I think we are going to sort of wrap this one up. We had like a whole bunch of questions, and I know if we had time and if we do have, we keep this bridge open, we're going to have a lot of discussions, but somehow or the other that we need to sort of space out these conversations and take some time to review the conversations we have had today and then think us through, and to then to be able to frame our responses to oncoming issues as well as existing issues. And I think what you pointed out, Kannan, is right, that the EVM is a technology and it represents a set of processes. Getting too fascinated and attached to the EVM and thinking that critique and examination is somehow questioning the sanctity of the EVM is harmful in many ways to democracy and how we deal with future innovations or introductions. And the idea that it needs to have better examination and far more public consultations is important. And that's the key. That's something we are trying to achieve. I'd like to thank you, of course, Kannan, for making time today. It's been absolutely fascinating. And I've been juggling quite a few message streams just to catch up with questions, comments, and remarks. It's one of those sessions, you know, how it happens. I also like to thank Shuman, because I think we never kind of were able to figure out how best to approach the topic of EBMs. And Shuman provided a very interesting insight that to be able to use a framework of cybersecurity and security and then have the conversation helps. So it's good that he could make time today. And also those who have been participating on YouTube, there's been a whole bunch of questions. And those who have joined us on Zoom, thank you again. Remember, our call for evidence continues to be open. I think today's session should be able to provide you with as to how we seek responses to it. We are planning to sum up the month-long activity that we have done through the month of May, produce a post to all those who have been following our project so that you get to know where we are, how we are going to take this forward. I just posted the link to the Telegram channel for Karana. Should you be interested in having the conversation, we can have that. If you have specific questions, comments, remarks for this session from Kannan, you can obviously leave them at the session page on the HasGeek site. And those would be emailed to him. And I just, once he gets time, he'll be able to respond. So with that, we're going to close the live stream, thanking all of you again. And see you around. A few of us are going to hang back to discuss further stuff off the record, off the live stream. So if you have time, you think you want to hang back, you're more than welcome to do that.
So I'm leaving. Bye.
Right. Stay safe. Thank you so much.
Kannan, thanks a ton. I mean, this was amazing.